I just said before we started, to those who are joining us, you may find that gallery view is the easiest view for you to see us all, as there are three of us on your sofa today. So welcome to all of those joining us today for what is our final and our fourth in our series of our Patient Capital on the Sofa webinars. For those of you who've seen me for the last 3 weeks, I apologise for this, because for those of you who are joining this week, my name's Karina Cobbold. I'm a partner at Mills & Reeve. I specialise in large-scale strategic land development, so working with patient capital in real estate investments on a daily basis. I thought you probably had enough from me asking the questions, so I'm joined by my colleague today, Tom Nash. Tom also works with our patient capital group. He also has an expertise in advising colleges, not only on longer term investments, but also on their range of portfolio investments and development work as well. And you'll see also on your screen, we've got Ian Keyes of Bidwells, but I'll give Ian a proper introduction shortly. Today, our topic for discussion is patient capital in the context of colleges, rural estates, and overseas investors. A little bit of housekeeping before we start. I did just say gallery view for those of you. I can see a few more have ticked in. Gallery view is the best one for you to see all three of us. If not speaker, we'll be jumping around in your living room or wherever you're sitting. It is being recorded, so if there's bits you miss or you have to take a call, there'll be an opportunity to hear this back. An email will be sent at the end of this to all of those people who signed up, and the recording link will be on there. As with all of our webinars, there is a ribbon along the bottom and a Q&A function. If you'd like to ask a question at any point, just pop it in there. I'll do my best to monitor them and try and weave questions in. We've had a lot of questions on these. So if I can't get to them during the course of the webinar, if you're happy to leave your name, I'll be able to marry that up with your email address, and I'll get your response following this webinar. I'll impose on a little bit of Ian's time afterwards and send you an email response. And then lastly, I do appreciate feedback. So when you log out, if you have a moment, if you could just give some feedback about what you've enjoyed about this series, what you've enjoyed about this webinar, anything else you'd like to hear about, and potentially any future webinar series you'd like to hear from Mills & Reeve. Doesn't just need to be linked to patient capital or specific long-term investment. It could be anything you'd like to hear from our real estate group. So before we start, a brief introduction to our guest, Ian Keyes. Ian comes with 27 years experience in the real estate sector, and although he's currently a partner at Bidwells, prior to that, he ran the real estate and investment team, a well-known wealth manager, where he increased assets under management from 200 million to 800 million. He was also the founding partner of the investment firm Clavis Walden, advising overseas fund investing in UK markets. Currently, he's responsible for new business, collective investment, wealth management and development management within the fund management team at Bidwells, based in Cambridge, where both his team and his office advise a broad range of rural estate clients, as well as university college endowment funds. Alongside all of this, they also have a leading practice in science and tech real estate in the Oxford to Cambridge arc. Now, we're going to split this webinar into three sessions. We're very lucky that Ian has got the expertise to talk on all three, so no pressure, Ian. The first section on colleges, Tom will take those questions. I'll then switch over to rural estates, and then we'll conclude with some questions on overseas investors. So without further ado, welcome, Ian, and thank you very much for joining us.
It's a pleasure. And over to Tom. Thanks, Karina, and thanks, Ian, for joining us today. So I suppose to start off with, I think it'd probably be fair to say that people would think of universities and college endowment funds as perhaps being the traditional patient capital investor in real estate. And I'd just be interested to hear from you, Ian, what patient capital might mean to a university or a college, and perhaps more specifically, what sort of timeframes they might be looking at in terms of a return on their real estate investments.
Sure, and they are very much the archetypal endowment fund, and the older the university, and obviously that particularly applies to Oxford and Cambridge. They've had endowment funds which have been running for hundreds of years. So yeah, they look at things in an entirely different way to a more traditional institutional fund. And the key to that is they're also not benchmarked by the industry. On say IPD numbers. So they don't have to look at a 1, 3, 5 year performance benchmark and be, you know, have marketing on that as well. So they sort of take life in a very different way. And they're made up of very different types of property as well, because they get gifted endowment property, particularly some of the older colleges. They've got very, very historical land ownings as well. And you know, those land ownings, as you know, the UK has become more built up and more developed, you know, those land ownings have gone from rural to commercial. So there's been huge change over a very, very long period. And they can view life, as I say, over that very long period as well. So without that sort of benchmarking, very short-term benchmarking, it's a completely different outlook for them. So I think you would find a lot of historical assets are, I mean, let's look at some of the Cambridge colleges, because that's a sort of on the doorstep for both businesses. You know, they own a lot of the retail in central Cambridge, and the upper parts, maybe say student accommodation, offices, whatever. So they are holdings that they will not be selling. They own those, and it's an integral part of the colleges and college life in Cambridge. So that's an element which is, they're not looking at trading, they're looking at just maximizing returns from those. Then we can look at properties they may have been gifted by previous students, which again, most likely have a connection, some sort of emotional connection to them, where they maybe wouldn't want to be trading them because they were gifted to them. And they've got, say, older rural estates where they can sell off, develop, etc. So these are really long-term projects. And with a number of those long-term projects within your portfolio, you can look at a new purchase and say, well, if nothing's going to happen for 20 years, but then we get a big uplift in value, we're happy with that, because we've always got activity going on within a large portfolio that is giving boosts of performance every now and then and creating those really good returns. So you don't have to look at it saying, well, I need performance out of that in 5 years because I'm a closed-ended fund and I've got a 5 to 7 year lifespan. And therefore I need to be able to trade that or trade the fund within 5 years, and I have to have got my performance from that asset. They don't have to do that. They can look at it in a different way. So it really is properly patient capital, where they can say, right, well, we can take that asset on now. It's giving us an income return, but the real kick in value is 15, 20 years down the line. Or we can, it's more strategic land. So we're looking at saying, let's develop this, or let's come up with a development plan over this and go through the planning process to add value. And that can take 5 to 10 years to do. So again, that's really patient capital. So you're buying in land at a really low cost, but then being able to add value in a long-term way, which just wouldn't fit many of the institutional funds. And even, I suppose, that some applies to some of the property companies. If you're a listed property company, you wouldn't have a portfolio too weighted with patient capital assets. I know some do, but not all that wouldn't apply to all of them. So it is very much a, you know, those older colleges and universities with those endowments really do have a different view on life because of the longevity and of the funds that are under management.
Thank you. Another kind of thing that I found interesting in all of the webinars that we've done in this series is that there's been a real theme of sustainability and responsible investing is something that's kind of coming through. And I know Anna spoke quite a lot about this last week, and something that RailPen sees, you know, perhaps building resilience in the investment that they're doing. To what extent do you see an increasing focus on sustainability as perhaps favouring patient capital investment over perhaps other forms of investment? Do the two go hand in hand? Is there a trend there, do you think?
There's certainly a trend. I mean, it's still relatively new in terms of something that people are looking at very, very seriously. And they certainly go hand in hand. this shouldn't be something that applies to university colleges or patient capital. This is something that really should apply to every single investor, because of all the obvious benefits from it. I think for for patient capital and maybe the endowment funds, they've got a longer term view, and therefore they can bring in all the sustainability elements over a longer period of time. And it does take time. We're talking about achieving these targets by 2050, and some people are trying to bring that forward and say, well, let's try and do it for 2040 instead. But that's still a long way off. So this is it's a long process. It's something that can't be done overnight. So yes, it does suit those funds. I think the light is really shining on funds at the moment to be sustainable, and with the better governance, etc., where people are really having to look at themselves and their responsibility. So it's certainly something that is in the spotlight at the moment, and we are working very hard advising colleges on all matters of sustainability to make sure we have things in process. So it's quite a long, complicated review procedure as well, to see what we can do to each portfolio to make sure we can be as sustainable as possible, draw up a plan and then implement that. But that does take time. So yes, a more patient capital will see the benefits over the portfolio. If you've got a back to a closed end fund example, over a 5 to 7 year lifespan, it's far more difficult to really see the benefits of that work over such a short period of time.
Thank you. And so is there a sense that is this something that that you're seeing universities and colleges being more interested in and taking into account, perhaps more sustainability being something that sort of drives the types of investments they're looking to do? Is that having an impact then, do you think, on what they're doing as well as more mainstream investors?
Yeah, very much so. I wouldn't say more than mainstream investors, because I think it's something that's hitting the industry overall. And there's large focus from a lot of the big institutions, as well as the more of the college endowment fund. So it's applying to the industry, and the industry is working on as a whole very, very hard. I think the industry has to grapple with what is deliverable over a shorter term and what will be deliverable over that longer term, and make sure that those plans are put in place and are achievable. There's no point talking about something if you've got a few years left on a fund's life and it's going to take 20 years to implement. You're not really going to scratch the surface. So it's about making sure you've got a sensible plan in on the portfolio you already own. When it comes to investing, now I think that's entirely different, and I think that sustainability has to be brought into everything. So you would look at a new asset and decide, look at its ratings now, look at what you can do with it over the period that you're intending to hold it for, and actually see what gains you can make over that period of time. And again, if you're only planning on holding that for a few years, it may be slightly more limited to something you say, right, well, that's going to be locked away for 15, 20 years, and we can do everything to it over that period of time. If you're looking at development, obviously it's slightly different to buying something with a 25-year lease on it, where you're a lot more restricted on what you can do. So again, having a really mixed portfolio allows you that flexibility to be able to apply those plans and work through them piece by piece as over your period of time.
I wonder if I might just come in there. A theme that I think is common both to colleges and also to what I would consider sort of rural estates and longer land-term holdings is that there isn't necessarily the pressure to have to sell, to make an immediate sale in order to realise some value. We talked about short-term investments, which can be anything between 3 and 5 years, so private equity timeframes, whereas actually colleges have the discretion to hold land for much longer because they don't need to. And similarly, rural estates, in my sort of dealings, I have the benefit of working with a lot of landowners, and they regard themselves very much as custodians of their land for the benefit of local communities and the future and future generations. In our second webinar, we heard about the stewardship model And in our third, we spoke about joint ventures and whether or not they would have more prominence in real estate and patient capital investments going forward. Mm. I know that you do a lot of work, or certainly you, as well as your team, do a lot of work with landowners who have large landholdings. I'd be interested to know from your experience their view of the stewardship model and whether or not it's something, if it got the necessary support of government, they would look to benefit from. And if so, what type of clients would you foresee that you act for taking this up?
Yeah, I mean, in short, yes, stewardship model is taken very seriously. We're advising a very wide range of clients on all sorts of matters to do with stewardship of rural estates, and have been for a number of years, but I suppose there's more spotlight now from the industry coming onto this as a subject matter. But we do, you know, it's all about biodiversity, you know, net gains, what can we do with carbon? You know, we have a big team up in Scotland who are into renewable energy and forestry. There's a huge focus on that at the moment in terms of investment, which is really driving prices, forestry prices. The land values are very, very low yielding because there's so much pressure to be able to buy forestry. And that needs very intensive management, but it's something that we're finding investors are very, very keen to do because, you know, particularly forestry, you know, there are returns out of timber as long as the timber prices are good. But we're also looking at, sequestering carbon and how that can be done. Is that through forestry? People have talked about peat, et cetera. So there's a range there as well of stewardship. So in order to, it's not just buying land, the land has to be run in the right way and the right quality as well. So it's really important that the land is looked after by people who actually know what they're doing. There's no point buying carbon credits and then finding out that actually the land hasn't been looked after and there isn't any carbon being locked away. So, that sort of stewardship of the land is really important. I think in terms of our rural estates as well, there is a real sense of responsibility in owning land and making sure that it's not just a commercial venture to farm it and make money. There is a responsibility to create natural habitats and protect natural habitats as well, and create eco corridors so that we have beneficial areas for wildlife, and they're not just sort of pocketed in small areas, because that it doesn't work. So there needs to be that sort of the linkage and spread across the countryside. And I think that is taken very, very seriously. And it's something we do advise on as well. So even if it's simple as keeping hedgerows to make sure there are berries for birds, those sorts of things are really important and are taken very seriously. So I think in terms of stewardship, that it particularly applies to long-term owners. Again, it's something that can be done over a long period of time. And the rural estates that we manage very much are that category of long-term landowners. So yeah, they do take it seriously. And more government support would be clearly gratefully received. But I think it's something we advise on and our clients are very keen to look at as well, because there is that sense of responsibility. And I think in terms of going back to Tom's point on the universities, again, it's the small things like looking at themselves and looking at what they own, and statues being taken down or being pressured to take people down. And that's students applying pressure to make sure that the those in governing positions look at what they're doing and take it responsibly. And that doesn't apply to statues or only to statues. That applies to the way they run the colleges and making sure that they are responsible and investing in the right things and making sure they manage those investments in the right way. So, yes, I think governance is hugely important and it's ever increasingly in the spotlight and therefore is an ever increasing part of someone's management strategy.
And the other thing that I'm always curious to look into, especially with those landowners, and I have the privilege of working with a number of large landowners who are looking to create enough land in order to bring forward a new community, a new opportunity. Often I find that in order for those schemes to work, we have to find some form of joint venture vehicle that makes it as tax efficient for all of those parties who come together in order to create that land holding. And I was interested in what Ali was saying last week, in that they were seeing a greater rise in the use of joint venture agreements. And his prediction was that we would see more use of joint venture agreements, because the nature of these large scale developments, for his example, is that you need to have a much longer term view, and therefore you need to pull in all the expertise as well as all the capital. Be interested to know what joint venture arrangements you've seen used by landowners, potentially by colleges, in order to bring their land holdings forward. And also in the future, whether or not you think this will continue to be used, and in what form. Will there be a new platform for joint ventures, or will it be much more of the same?
I think in terms of new platforms, that's really governed by what happens in government policy and you know, what we are and aren't allowed to do. But I think, so I would keep an open mind to that, because we've had changes over the last 10, 15 years on those. I think, yeah, joint ventures are very important for us, and we do see a number of joint ventures coming through where, you know, to it's easy to talk about this if you use an example. You know, if you're a farmer and you've got a 100 acres, and it's arable, its agricultural value would be, say, 10,000-12,000 an acre. But you want to put some distribution in, and you could, that could be £600,000-£700,000 an acre. So there's a huge increase in value, but you don't want to sell out at 12,000 an acre. You don't really want to sell out at 30,000 an acre, because you've added a bit of hope value to it. You want to maximize the value of your land. So that's when you would go into a joint venture with a developer, to make sure you're getting, you know, your fair share of the upside as well. So we're seeing a lot more awareness and that sort of style of setup being brought in with the rural estates, because they may be sort of asset rich and cash poor. You know, they haven't necessarily got the cash to be able to fund an expensive planning process. Hence, they want to bring in joint venture partners with the expertise and the additional equity available to take them through that process. Because, you know, running a rural estate is a business in its own right, and it's not, yeah, that's not a business set up to run planning. Whereas, so if you bring the joint venture, you're bringing the land ownership and the skill base, the development skill base, in together. So we certainly do see a lot of joint ventures, and there are a number of clients that we deal with, both rural and developers, who we can, you know, put together for, be they residential or commercial developments. I think in terms of the colleges, they do joint ventures as well. Again, it depends on the college and how much equity they have available. The joint ventures are certainly something they look at, particularly on the larger schemes. On the smaller ones, they tend to be able to run them themselves. But I think a well-publicized joint venture would be something like a Cambridge Science Park, where Tusk came in as a joint venture partner and funded the new developments which are going on at Cambridge Science Park, which have been, they're incredible buildings, and they're really changing the face of Cambridge Science Park. And that funding partnership has worked extremely well in terms of, you know, attracting some fantastic new tenants, providing amazing new facilities, and really helping to change and modernize the profile of Cambridge Science Park, so it stays and is seen as very much the place to be in terms of science and tech. So the benefits of those joint ventures are very visible, and particularly with the focus on Cambridge and Oxford through COVID and the vaccine development, etc., and science and tech overall, it's really important that we do stay at the leading edge of the market. So those joint ventures have proved, you know, invaluable in being able to push forward those, you know, very well-known sites and keep them at the sort of the front edge where they need to be.
And just one other thing I wanted to pick up on. Obviously, you do a lot of work on the ARC. I know you hosted a webinar exactly on that very thing. In terms of the ARC, what type of patient capital investments are you seeing along the ARC, that those that you can talk about? Is there the one that's coming to the fore more than we've talked about science parks? Is there sort of themes that come out of that in terms of investment along that route?
There are. I mean, I think in science parks, that's a difficult topic in terms of, you can't build something and brand it a science park. You know, you need to have various elements to make a science park work. So has it got extraordinary research facilities? Is it linked close to a university with the research facilities from that university? Is there a really major employer or business there which is going to attract other businesses to be there and to form that cluster? So they're the sort of elements that really go into making a science park. So I can't just buy a business park, branded a science park, and hope some people are going to come along. So that takes, I suppose it is more patient capital, because it takes a lot longer to be able to get that culture of a science park, to make it really successful and make it attractive and make it function as a science park, as opposed to just a collection of businesses on a business park. So that probably is a longer term, and therefore does apply to more patient capital. So that would apply definitely across the arc. I think alternatively, there are on residential developments as well. We've seen, yeah, that is a hugely important part for the growth of the arc, because it's got to be sustainable development. So though we can't just go and build new small towns across the arc and say, yes, we've ticked the boxes, we've put all the housing in that's required, because it has to be near business. It has to be sustainable. So people aren't just living in the arc and traveling to Oxford and Cambridge to go to work, because that completely defeats the object of what we're trying to achieve. So I think from that point of view, you'll see a lot of investor interest or developer interest, but that it will take time for that to come through, to come to fruition. You know, we've got infrastructure going in with the East-West Rail. There are, although the main road, the expressway, is not going to be built in its entirety, there are some major junction upgrades going on as well, which will create different nodes across the arc as well, which will be a stimulus for investment and development. So again, that has to be patient, you know, and you know, changing road junctions doesn't happen in 2 to 3 years. You know, they are long-term plans that take 10 years. East-West Rail is planned to be operational by 2030. And I hope that doesn't slip, because it is really important to make that work and allow more free-flowing movement across the arc. But it is also not there to create a dumbbell effect and just allow people to get to Oxford and Cambridge to go to work. So in terms of residential development, the house builders know that they're in for the long haul, and they will work with landowners to say, well, look, you know, to have options, etc., and try and work through those planning phases. But they can't just go and build new towns. They have to have business, and they have to have that sustainable nature to them. So everybody's just not traveling huge distances. People want to be able to work, you know, closer to home. And I think this, you know, COVID actually over the last year has probably amplified that fact as well, that yes, people are working from home. We all miss the office and we're all desperate to get back in and have that interaction that we get in an office, but we don't necessarily all want to be commuting long distances on trains together as well. So there is a happy medium of actually saying, well, we can have more localized employment, but it's got to be built and created in the right way. So yeah, those investors and developers are in for the long haul to see that happen. The government are hugely behind the arc and are investing a lot of time and money into those processes. So they will speed it up as much as they can. And they've got an incredible willingness from the industry to support them on that as well, which is, again, very exciting. But it's more, as it's certainly not a sort of 2 to 3 year program. This is going to be, you know, certainly longer than that.
And it fits in with the phrase places rather than houses, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. It does. And it's really important. You know, it is about placemaking. It's about creating communities. And as I say, it has to be somewhere that is desirable to live and you're proud to live in. And that's what we're trying to look at creating. It's not just housing that's convenient, affordable, and close to a somewhere to with some transport access. It's more than that. It's making it into a very desirable community to live, which is also creating success in the science and tech industries as well.
Thank you. I'm going to let Tom ask some questions on overseas investment. If not, I'm going to take up all your time on my section. So I'm going to pass to Tom.
Thanks, Karina. And Ian, you've already mentioned the TUS investment into the science park, which is obviously segues neatly into overseas investment. Hmm. We heard last week that levels of investment into UK real estate have remained quite remarkably resilient over the Brexit years, and obviously more recently the COVID-19 global pandemic, and that the UK still ranks, I think it was second globally in terms of volumes of investment, which is obviously fantastic for anybody working in the UK real estate market. I know this is something that particularly interests you and you've got some clients in who are overseas investors. Be interested to hear what sort of trends you're seeing in terms of overseas investment into UK real estate, and perhaps specifically how much of that is what you'd call patient capital investment.
Yeah, I think there is certainly interest there, very strong interest. The UK remains an attractive market because of its transparency and our regulation, our legal system. So, you know, the UK is very well set up for overseas investors. I think there's probably a slight slowdown over COVID because it's created some uncertainty. It's also prevented people coming and visiting. And these are, you know, assets that, you know, you want to see. You have to see them to understand how they're going to work and the locations, etc. So I think there's probably slowed down a bit of investment. And that will sort of wash through in numbers over this year as well. But there is still very much a willingness to invest. I think there probably is a slight hesitation at the moment until the big question on offices has been understood and resolved in terms of, are people downsizing enormously? Are they downsizing a bit? Is it no change at all? You know, I think that needs to come out in the wash and to let people understand exactly where the market is going to settle down. But, you know, so that, and that really applies to the London market as well, where the main focus of overseas investment has always been. But we do certainly see a particular willingness to, from overseas investors, and certainly into the science and tech arena, which then obviously applies to the ARC as well, but also other locations in the UK. You know, Manchester has got an excellent science and tech scene as well. So I think it's something that the overseas investors certainly want to carry on investing in the UK. I think in terms of patient capital, it's really interesting then to look at the background of those investors to understand them in more detail. And I think Singapore is a really interesting market to look at for that, because you've got a number of different types of investors there. So you've got a lot of state-owned state-backed pension funds who would probably view themselves as relatively patient capital. They're less hung up on short-term benchmarking, but it's still something they certainly look at. You've also got a large number of companies over there who may be more privately owned, who've made money in terms of their domestic real estate or commodities trading. So they're different types of investors, and they are far more patient and take a long-term view. They will only buy freeholds, for instance. They don't want to buy leaseholds. They don't want to enter funds. They want to be able to run everything themselves, either own it themselves or develop it themselves. So they like the control, and they are far more patient. They will take a really long-term view on something as well. And if it takes, you know, a number of years before the ability to develop or redevelop is there, absolutely fine. It's all about the quality of the location and the quality of the asset. So these are canny, well-educated investors who've been investing over in the UK for a number of years. So they know the market well. They know what works in their own domestic market. So they really do know what they're doing there. They are intelligent investors and will be, you know, picky, quite rightly picky about what they put their money into. But when they go, they tend to go big, and they tend to make some really interesting plays as well. So they fit that mold of patient capital, although there's more sort of family, privately owned, large investors.
And perhaps thinking specifically about those sort of larger, you know, family owned private investors, are there lessons that UK investors could learn from them? It sounds as though there's perhaps some sort of cultural differences in their approach to their investment. Are there things that they get right that perhaps UK investors could learn from?
I wouldn't say that as such, because I think that almost implies the UK investors aren't as sophisticated, which I'm certainly not going to say that. I think that might cause some upset, and I wouldn't say that anyway. I think I wouldn't say there are things we can learn. I think there are, if anything, some of their criteria hold them back slightly, because the UK market is very different. So we do have, you know, long leaseholds, and that's a very historic nature of the UK market. So it does prevent them from from entering a lot of what would be really good investment opportunities. So there are large chunks of the West End, for instance, that they're not going to be able to own. You know, if it's a Grosvenor freehold, they're not going to be able to touch it. So it does prevent them buying into certain sectors in the market. And in terms of those joint ventures as well, we talked about earlier on joint ventures with the landowners over here as well. And I think, again, that's if you want freeholds and you want control, you're not going to necessarily enter into joint venture with a landowner over here. But our land model is very different to land models in some of the Asian countries where there's more land. And certainly US investors have that as well, where, you know, land is far more readily available. So the value of the land itself in the UK is quite a prominent part of a development, which isn't so prominent in other areas of the world. So again, the UK market is different there, and that understanding that and allows us to be very open-minded in terms of what we can do in development and build that into our appraisals, where overseas investors may struggle a little bit more with that. So I wouldn't say we can learn off them. I think there are just differences in the UK market, which again, they have to grapple with, which they're not used to.
Thank you. Perhaps a kind of slightly kind of larger question, the million-dollar question, perhaps the billion-dollar question. For investors who are looking to make patient capital investments in the kind of near future, where do you see the biggest opportunities at the minute? And I'm interested both sort of geographically, but also sort of by asset types. Are there specific assets and sectors and specific regions that you see as offering the biggest prizes?
Yeah, that is a broad question.
I think probably going last, Ian. You get it all pulled exactly. In together.
I know, we've got a cut-off time as well, I've got to admit. I'll keep this short. So I think in terms of geographically, I think the ARC, I'm going to say the ARC obviously is our area, but I actually genuinely think that it does present a really, really interesting opportunity for a government-backed region of the UK, where they are putting money into infrastructure to help develop. So we're seeing some really radical changes. We've seen the recent spatial framework released by MHCLG, which is really a change to the planning system as well, to enable, and it's not finalized yet, it's just their proposal, and that will be finalized by the end of 2022, which, you know, in government terms, I think is quick. It's really good movement. It's great to see the support coming through from the government. And that will really open up more development opportunity in the ARC. So that will really apply to patient capital and those willing to enter into joint ventures with landowners as well. So there will be a lot happening in the ARC over the next 5, 10, 20 years, which I think does present a really, really good opportunity. So geographically, I'd say that's a region that is well worth the focus. In terms of sectors, I think for patient capital, energy and infrastructure are absolutely vital. We do need investment into our infrastructure. And I'm not just talking about roads. There's a lot of infrastructure that is needing to be updated and changed as we change the way we work and operate as well. So the way that we travel will be different. Our energy consumption is different. The way our national grid is put together is going to change a lot as well, with different technologies coming in for renewable energy, waste to energy, et cetera, hydrogen even coming in as well. So there will be significant changes to energy and infrastructure. And I think they, as a sector, that will present really good investment opportunities for patient capital. But you know, that comes with the warning. You've really got to understand what you're putting your money into and how it's going to work and how you're going to get your returns out of it. Does that suit your return criteria and profile? Because it will be long term. But I think there will be some very, very interesting opportunities coming out in those sectors over the coming years.
I think we've got time to squeeze in one question from our audience. So I'm going to limit you to 3 minutes.
Right.
So, Ian, question from William. How do you differentiate patient capital from lazy capital with the promise of jam tomorrow against performance today?
That's an interesting question. I think if you put that to some of the bursars of the colleges and said, was it lazy capital, you might get some funny looks. It's patient capital is it if you've got a portfolio of patient capital, you're still working that portfolio very, very hard, because we're not talking about one asset on its own. You're talking about a portfolio with a number of assets that are delivering their returns over a number of years. So that could be land that you've sat on for 20, 30 years or more that is then, you're then working on a development for it, which is a lot of hard work. And if you've got a number of different developments coming on over the next 10 years, there's an awful lot of work to do. So I certainly wouldn't say it's lazy capital. I'd say it's just it's the ability to take a long-term view, because your portfolio is operated, has always been set up to operate in that way as well. So you haven't had to look at a five-year benchmark or a one-year benchmark. You're not operating a closed-end fund which has a seven-year life or 5 to 7 year life. You know, you're talking about portfolios of hundreds of years where there is always activity, and therefore these portfolios are actually really, really hard to manage, because there's so much going on, so many different types of assets, so you need different types of expertise to run them as well. So they do tend to be very complicated portfolios to run, and you do have to have actually a very broad range of expertise to be able to run them properly. So it's certainly not lazy capital, it's patient capital that has to be worked very hard to make sure that each element of that portfolio is always delivering to its maximum.
Thank you. So everyone, I'm going to draw it to a close there. I hope that's okay with everyone, because we've got a few minutes to spare. It was just, thank you very much, Ian, for sitting on our sofa. I'm sorry you got the hard question at the end. That's what happens when we bring all together. Tom had the pleasure of asking that one. To all of those who are attending, thank you for attending over the last 4 weeks, however many you've attended. I hope you've enjoyed them. Please do give us feedback when you log out of any you'd like to hear from us in the future, whether it's related to specific investment, development, landlord and tenant. We're very happy to cover any topic. Finally, that just leaves me to say, for my guests who are watching, thank you very much to all of my guests who have sat on the sofa, my virtual sofa, for the last 4 weeks. And to everyone else who's attended today, just wish you the best for the rest of your week, and hopefully we'll see you at future Mills and Mead webinars. Many thanks.